Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I think we can resume now. I just want someone to confirm whether they can hear me clearly and also they can see my slide. I'm going to pick on who is on the top. Ella, can you hear me and can you also see my slides? Maybe not Ella. Ruth, can you hear me? And you can also see the slides. Am I on mute? No, I'm not on mute. Melissa, can you hear me? And can you also see the slides? Okay, brilliant. Okay. So we got to passenger motor vehicles. So there's also some noise on passenger motor vehicles. So what is a passenger motor vehicle? A passenger motor vehicle is a motor vehicle propelled by mechanical or electrical power and intended or adapted for use or capable of being used on roads, mainly for the conveyance of passengers. A passenger motor vehicle embraces station wagons, estate cars, vans, 4x4, double cabs, and so forth. And that's just the definition of a passenger motor vehicle, and also have the seating capacity of 15 people or less. So what do we exclude from passenger motor vehicles? We are going to exclude the vehicles used for conveyance of passengers for gain, like the taxis, the commuter buses, etc. That is not a passenger motor vehicle. Number two, yes, is that a question? Was that a question? Okay, that's fine. We're also going to exclude from passenger motor vehicles used by hotel operators to convey their guests. Then we are also going to exclude vehicles carrying more than 15 people, excluding the driver. You might have noticed come across a textbook saying a passenger motor vehicle should be able to carry 15 people or less, but that will be including the driver. In this case, we are saying we are excluding vehicles carrying 15 or more people, excluding the driver. Okay, that's just the same thing. Vehicles purchased by a taxpayer for leasing under a finance lease, we are going to exclude them. Then caravans and ambulances, those are not passenger motor vehicles. Okay, so what are the capital allowance consequences on motor vehicles? One, capital allowance on a passenger motor vehicle are computed based on a maximum cost of 100,000. So we're going to deem the cost to be 100,000 in the case that the passenger motor vehicle cost exceeds this amount. A vehicle which is not a passenger motor vehicle qualifies for capital allowances based on its full cost. Okay. All motor vehicles, passenger motor vehicle will not qualify for special initial allowance upon election. So that's the only criteria that we want to qualify motor vehicles for SIA is upon election and if it is used at least 90% for purpose of trade. Where special initial allowance is not being granted, they are granted VAT at 20%. So we said that's an exception. Normally, movables, we grant wear and tear 10%, but for passenger motor vehicle, for motor vehicles, is an exception. And then we charge the 20% on the income tax value, the ITV. That is the net book value in the eyes of the accountant. But in the eyes of the taxman, we rather call it the income tax value. Okay, so we have this quiz. Wanda Hotel purchased the following vehicles during the year ended 31 December 2020. One, it was an Isuzu double cab for the managing director, that is 320. Then we have the Nissan Navara double cab for the procurement manager, or for procurement. Then we have Toyota Noah for collection, for collecting guests from airport. Then staff bus, then Nissan pickup 2.7 allocated the marketing manager. So the question is, state with the reasons which of the following of the above vehicles are passenger motor vehicle and which ones are not. Okay, so for time purpose, we're just going to go to the answer, but here, this one is a passenger motor vehicle based on the criteria that we said it should carry less than 15 people, and also that this list of the assets, and also it is not being used to convey passengers for gain. So we're also going to use this criteria to determine whether these assets are passenger motor vehicle. So this one is a passenger motor vehicle. It meets all the criteria. Then this one also is a passenger motor vehicle. But now the Toyota Noah, this one can carry more than 15 people, this one. So this one is not a passenger motor vehicle. The same applies to the staff bus and also the Nissan pickup. Okay, that's the answer. Here we have the Isuzu. It's a private motor, it's a passenger motor vehicle because the reason carrying less than 15 passengers. I think that's the most important criteria. And then we have Navara, the same criteria. Then Toyota Noah, used in the business for gain. So that's what we said here. We said passenger motor vehicle excludes vehicle used to convey passengers for gain. So the Noah is being used to convey passengers for gain. So it's not a passenger motor vehicle. Okay, then that was the answer. Then let's quickly go to farm improvements. What are the capital gains? Yes. Yes. Nissan pickup, you know those vans, they can carry. Have we ever seen them carrying like workers to mines? There will be 20 workers in that backside of the What do you think? Okay, so is the criteria saying the asset should not be used to carry more than 15 people? It is saying that the asset, the motor vehicle on its own, should not have a carrying capacity of more than 15 people. It's saying the motor, we are excluding the motor vehicles that can carry up to 15 passengers, or not excluding the driver. So it's not like the asset is being used to carry people. But if it can carry more than 15 people, then that means that asset is not a passenger motor vehicle. I don't know, what do you think others, whenever we have a situation like this one, we can always discuss and agree. What do you think? So who was that? Let me just see. It was Rumbiza. Rumbiza is thinking that we should not categorize the Nissan as a passenger motor vehicles. What do you think others? Caroline, what do you think? Who else is online? All right, Caroline, yes, what do you think? Okay, thank you. What do you think, Simba? Simba, is he online? Okay. Ruth, what do you think? Because of the same reason. Okay, thank you. Betty, what do you think? Do you also agree with everyone else, or you agree with Rumbiza? Okay, but I like Rumbiza's thinking. This one, if I had my way, I would rather say this asset is a passenger motor vehicle, because like the distinction is not quite clear. It looks like if we are going to use Rumbiza's suggestion, we are saying, because normally do we use a Nissan to carry people, to carry passengers? No, we'll be carrying goods in that backside. So we normally can't say it carries 15 people, although we can illegally use it to carry people, but you can actually be arrested for carrying people in that backyard, because normally it's not used for carrying passengers. But for the purpose of this session, let's just say it's not a passenger motor vehicle. We are going you can actually pose a question in that taxation group and see what other people think. But that was a very good observation, Robert. I thank you. Okay, that was the quiz. Then we go to farm improvements. A farm improvement means any building, works, or structure of permanent nature, e.g. sheds, roads, canals, deep tanks, bridges, water furrows, etc., used in farming operations. It includes any building whose construction commenced on or after 1 April 1988. Yeah, I should take note of these days. They can actually hound you in examination setup. And used as a school or as a medical establishment, a hospital, a nursing home, or a clinic in connection with the farming operations. So for it to qualify as a farm improvement, more than 50% of the farm's force must be children of the farmer workers. That's the first criteria. Then the second criteria is more than 50% of the patients must be farm workers and their families. Okay. A farm improvement includes any building used wholly or mainly for the housing of staff employed at the school or at a medical establishment, staff houses for teachers and nurses. The housing for all other farm employees who are not teachers or nurses are staff housing as defined above. Okay. All buildings, works or structure of a permanent nature used in connection with the farming operations are farm improvements. But however, recreational amenities such as beer halls, cinema, swimming pools, social clubs, etc., often found on the farms are, however, not farming improvements. A farmer's dwelling or homestead used or occupied by a taxpayer and his family is specifically disqualified as a farm improvement. You take note of that one. Okay, we continue farm improvements as follows. The following are the limits or deemed costs for purpose of capital allowance on farm improvement. So one, any residential unit used by the staff employed at the school, hospital, nursing home or clinic, teachers and nurses houses, they are limited to 100,000. Okay, I will repeat that one. Any residential unit, now it differs from that, from the staff housing that we discussed earlier, because we know that staff houses are limited to 250. But in this case, for farm improvements purposes, any residential unit used by staff employed at the school, hospital, nursing home or clinic, that is teachers and nurses houses, the cost is limited to 100 or is deemed to be 100,000. Then any residential unit which is used for housing the taxpayers' employees and their families, it becomes 250. So be aware of this distinction. The first one, we're talking about teachers and nurses. They are not actually working on the in the farming activity, but they are like tutoring like the children of the farmers or the workers of the farm. Okay, so their residential unit, the cost is deemed to be 100,000, but for the residential unit which is used for housing the taxpayers' employees and their families, 250. Then any one such school, hospital, nursing home or clinic is also limited to 100,000. And these figures are no longer reasonable. Maybe they already revised this one, but we shall see later. For employees, staff houses, the whole amount is ignored if the cost per unit exceeds 250. So now we are talking about this scenario, this one, for any residential unit for the taxpayers' employees and their families. These ones are not taxpayers' employees, they are government employees, they are civil servants. So their residential unit is limited to 100,000, but then for the taxpayer employees, it is increased to 250. But in the case that it exceeds 250, then we said that for employees staff house, the whole amount is ignored if the cost per unit exceeds. So this statement is just the same as what we discussed under staff housing. It's just a staff housing because this residential unit, they meet the definition of a staff housing. Okay. A constructed farm improvement qualifies for special initial allowance where a taxpayer has made an election for it. Where an election for CI has not been made or the farm improvement acquired, where entity granted on the item at the rate of 5% of the cost per annum. Okay, so we discuss this when special initial allowance is not granted, then we grant WNT. Okay, so we have a quiz. We have Mr. Gara bought a farm for 2.6 million. The price includes, so this 2.6 is split into the cost of land, which is 900,000. Then we have a greenhouse of 800,000, then we have a farmhouse of 300,000, then we have 600,000 for 2 units of staff housing, He added a school and a house for three teachers, costing 500 and 900, 300 per unit, respectively. Okay. So the question was supposed to be, I didn't put the question, okay. But the question was supposed to be, or is supposed to be, which cost is going to be used for capital allowance purposes? Are we going to, because if we add this, plus this, plus this, plus this, plus these ones, they should be equal to this one, if I'm not mistaken. So are we going to you? Okay, so it should be this one, plus this one, plus this one, plus this one. Yes, these ones are different. So the farm was initially bought for 2,600, but from this 2,600, it was including this land, the greenhouse, the farmhouse, and six and two units of staff housing. Then he added these improvements. So the question is, which ones are we going to use as, which amount are we going to use for capital allowance purposes? Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, this one is a practice question. Using these limits, you are going to determine which of these should be, which amount out of all these amounts given on this slide should be used for capital allowance purposes. Okay, so it's a practice. I'm just going to give you, where is my cursor? I'm just going to give you only 5 minutes to answer this one. You are going to put your answer in the chat box. So I just want one figure here, and you also explain how you got that figure. So I'm just giving you 5 minutes. So now it's 8:33 by 8:38. Then I should be able to see your answers in the chat box. So 5 minutes, only 5 minutes sharp. Thank you. Okay, it's now 8:38. I think we can now revise. Let me just see what we have here. From Caroline, we have a lady does not rank for capital allowances. Good. Greenhouse 800, ranking asset. Then farm house disqualified. Staff house disqualified. Then school limited to 100. Then teacher's house limited to 300. I think that one was quite brilliant. Does not rank for capital allowance at all. Farmhouse excluded, specially excluded. Yes, staff housing cost exceeds 250. Then disqualified. Then okay. Then does not rank for. The teacher's house limited to 100, greenhouse at 4. Yeah, I think that was quite brilliant. For those that have put in their responses here, I think that was quite brilliant. Let's just go to the answer and see. Do we still have any other? No. So let's just go to the answer. Good. Okay, so the land not non-ranking asset, greenhouse ranking asset at 4. Farmhouse is specially excluded, then staff housing disqualified, cost exceed 250, then school limited 100, then teachers houses ranking assets cost limited 100 per unit. Okay, I think you were all good. That was it. So we have many other assets that we are not going to cover today. Like what else do we have? Like those machinery, we say capital allowances, the special initial allowance is granted because machinery is a movable asset. So capital allowance, special initial allowance is granted only on election, even though the machinery second hand. Okay, so that's it for machinery. And in the case that it is disqualified somehow for some reasons, special wear and tear is granted at 10% generally, Then at 17.5%, if the asset has two shifts per day, then if asset has three shifts per day, then wear and tear is granted at 25%, and so on. That's it for machinery. Okay, so for those other assets, all those assets, the general rules apply. If it is a movable building, immovable asset, wear and tear is 5%. If it is a movable asset, wear and tear is at 10%. Okay, so let's just talk a little bit about scrapping allowance, but in its basic form, scrapping allowance is just like a loss on disposal. But a scrapping allowance arises when an asset is disposed of for less than its income tax value. It is computed and deductible in terms of paragraph 4 of the fourth schedule of the Act. It does not necessarily mean a scrapping allowance from a sale. Even a mere cessation of use of the asset can give rise to the scrapping allowance. Okay, the asset should be used up or discarded or no longer used by taxpayer for purpose of his trade. This should be proceeded by a decision to scrap the asset. That is, the asset should be worn out and no longer usable. The commissioner should be satisfied that the asset has become useless for business purposes or has been discarded with no intention to use it again. Okay, when the asset was not used exclusive for business purpose, then only scrapping allowance applicable to the use of the asset is in business is deductible. In cases where an asset is initially used for private purposes and then introduced into the taxpayer's business, any scrapping allowance is calculated with reference to the value introduced and not the original cost. I shall revisit this statement in the next few slides. Okay, so we just have an example. A taxpayer sold an asset for 23,000. The asset was used 30% private. It was originally purchased for 230, and ITV on date of sale is 66,000. Okay, so the question is, what is the deductible scrapping allowance? Okay. So we are told that the net book value, let me just call it the net book value, the ITV, we are told that it is 66,000, but we are only selling it. So as of that date, we are saying we have an asset worth 66,000, but now the asset we are selling it is 23,000. That is, we are selling it at a loss. So the scrapping allowance that we are going to grant on this asset, it will be the ITV, then we subtract 23,000. Okay, that will be the potential scrapping allowance. But because that this asset was used only 70% for business, we're going to multiply this by 70%, and the result will be our scrapping allowance. Okay, that's what I meant when I said in cases where an asset is initially was not used exclusively for business purpose, then only the scrapping allowance applicable to the use of the asset in the business is deductible. In this case, this is how we would calculate the scrapping allowance related to the business usage. Oh, so this is 70%, not 7. Okay. Then let's go to recoupment. We have been singing about the recoupment again and again, and now we are doing it in detail. So recoupment is brought into gross income in terms of Section 8, subsection 1, subsection I of the Act. A recoupment of capital allowances is the difference between the selling price and the asset's income tax value, but restricted to the amount previously allowed as capital allowances. That's if you attended previous sessions, I think we once calculated the requirement was it on site assignment on partnership. Was it partnership in yes, I remember on one of those sessions we calculated the requirement where we were comparing the selling price minus the ITV and we call this one potential recruitment. Then we say the cost minus ITV, these are the capital allowances, and we call it ordinary recruitment. So the lesser of these two, we compare this, the lesser of these two will be the recruitment. Okay. So that's what the we are saying here. We are saying a recoupment of capital allowances is the difference between the selling price and the asset's income tax value, but restricted to the amounts previously granted as capital allowance. So we are effectively applying this one. The selling price should be kept at the original cost of the asset. For assets that qualified on a deemed cost, a deemed selling price should be used instead of actual selling price. This is explained below. Okay. Recoupment is brought into gross income in the year in which a sale agreement is concluded, regardless of the fact that the proceeds are received in installments running in 2 years of assessment subsequent to the year of sale. I trust that you have watched that video that I was explaining the suspensive sale allowance or the high purchase allowance. I tried to cover everything on that video as far as the suspensive sale allowance is concerned on CGT and also on business income. Okay, when an asset is damaged or destroyed and compensation is then applied in constructing or purchasing a similar asset within 18 months of the date of the damage or destruction of the original asset, and such new asset is brought into use 3 years of the damage or destruction, recoupment applicable to the so expended compensation shall not be taxed. Okay, I think that is self-explanatory. Do we have a quiz? Yes, XY Limited constructed a manufacturing building in June 2016 for 1.5 million, and the building has been in use since then. In 2020, it closed its business and sold the asset for 1.7. So the question is, you are required to show XY Limited's maximum tax liability, taxable income. Okay, so we are just here in such a situation. We have two things here. We have capital gains and we also have recoupment, but because we are focusing on income tax, we're not going to cover capital gains on this particular question. We are only going to focus on recoupment. Okay, so we are saying recoupment, we compare two things. We say the first thing, we say the selling price less ITV, which is the potential recoupment. In this case, our selling price is 1,700,000. Less what is our ITV? This asset was constructed. It was a manufacturing building, so it's an industrial building, constructed in June 2016. Then it is sold in 2020. That means we would have claimed special initial allowance for the year of purchase, then 2017, 2018, 2019. So we actually claimed capital allowance in full in 2019. So when we are now selling this asset in 2020, we had already claimed special capital allowance in full, of which we are saying ITV is the net book value for tax purposes. So in this case, in 2020, we no longer have a net book value on this asset. We no longer have the ITV. So the ITV is zero. So the potential recoupment is 1,700. Okay. Then we are going to say we compare it to ordinary recoupment. Ordinary recoupment should be the cost of the asset less the ITV. And in this case, what is our cost? It is 1,500,000. If we deduct ITV zero, the answer will remain 1,500,000. Okay. So we say recoupment is the lesser of the two. We compare this one to this one. So recoupment effectively will be 1,500 because that's the lesser. This one is called the ordinary recoupment. This one is called the potential recoupment. Then we compare the two. The lesser of the two is recoupment. So recoupment in our case will be equal to 1,500. I hope that one is very clear. Then here the answer is selling price up to the original cost. Now it was trying to apply this statement that we said, where was it? A recoupment of capital allowance is the difference between the selling price and the asset income tax value, but restricted to the amounts previously allowed as capital allowances. Okay, so that's how practically it was being, we restricted the selling price up to the 1,500 that we granted as capital allowances. Okay. Note that SIA and actually we and TA claimed is equal to 100%. I explained this one. Okay, so we have the problem or the case of a deemed selling price. We said earlier that when was it? Document is brought. There was a statement that in the case where an asset is initially, that was not the statement. Okay, let's just go to this our slide. Okay, assets that qualify for capital allowances based on the restricted cost, e.g. passenger motor vehicles, we said it is restricted to 100,000. Schools, we also said they are restricted to 100,000. Hospitals, we said they are restricted to 100,000. And residential units for teachers, they are also restricted to 100,000. Should have their selling price restricted for purpose of computing recoupment. The restricted selling price referred to as deemed selling price is computed as follows. So how do we restrict the selling price? We are going to say the deemed cost in this case it will always be 100,000 because that's our restriction, divided by the original cost. Maybe the asset costed 100,000. Then you multiply by the actual selling price. Maybe we are now selling the asset for 500,000. So that amount here will be our deemed selling price, provided that the deemed selling price should not exceed the deemed cost. Okay, so the deemed selling price should always be less than this deemed cost. Okay, so if this quiz XY Limited, I'm trying to rush with time. I want to finish capital allowance today so that we will move next week with speed. XY Limited sold a passenger motor vehicle for 250 during the year. The car had been acquired in 2017 for 300,000. Okay. So we are going to say the deemed selling price here will be equal to, obviously we would have restricted this one to 100,000. Then we divided by the original cost of the asset, which is 300,000, which is this one. Then multiply by the actual selling price. XY Limited. Okay, 250,000. So the answer here will be our deemed selling price. Okay, so the deemed selling price, if we say 250,000 divided by 3, our deemed selling price will be equal to 83333. Okay, that's our deemed selling price. Okay, So how are we going to calculate recoupment? We calculate it in the same way. We compare selling price minus ITV. What will be our ITV in this case? Okay, this passenger motor vehicle, we restricted the cost to 100,000 from 2017. So that means we're claiming a VAT on this asset for 2017, 18, 19 on the restricted cost. So that means we are going to say this deemed selling price minus ITV. Okay, then we compare it to cost, the deemed cost of 100,000 minus ITV. We compare these two, this one and this one, the lesser of the two will be equal to our recoupment. Okay, so the answer is selling price, which is this one, calculated as the deemed cost divided by the original cost multiplied by 250, then less ITV. So would we have claimed for how many years? For 3 years, 2017, 2018, 2019. So our ITV now will be equal to 25%. Okay. So if we say the cost, the 100,000 minus 25,000 will be equal to 75,000, isn't it? Then we say 83,333,000 minus 25,000. Obviously, this one is the lesser. That's why I just showed the calculations for this part only. So our recoupment will be equal to 5,833. I know that that can be a complex adjustment in an examination setup, but just take note of how we were calculating on this slide. Okay. The end. This is the end of capital allowance. I'm just glad that we finished capital allowances today. Next week, we are going to dig deep into other allowances. Then maybe on Tuesday, we go to gross income. Then if we are done, we can then go to those special economic zones or those withholding taxes and those income that can be finalized by withholding, or that can be satisfied by final withholding taxes. I'm going to cover all that next week. Hopefully by Friday we'll be done with business income. I think I have a feeling that even this semester, Mr. Mshure is going to just give an examination with taxation of companies and individuals on trading and investment income only. So you should be very comfortable with this topic. Okay. Do we have any questions as far as capital allowances are concerned? I wonder why you don't ask questions. Is either what I was explaining was very clear or you didn't understand anything? I would just assume earlier. Okay. Otherwise, if you don't have questions, ladies and gentlemen, okay, we have Betty. Do you have a question? The 100. Okay. That's a very good question. You mean the 100 that we're using here? Okay. This one. What am I doing? Let me just find my highlighter. Oh, you mean this 100,000? Okay. This was a motor vehicle, a passenger motor vehicle. Remember, was it a passenger motor vehicle? Yes, it was a motor vehicle, not passenger motor vehicle. It was a passenger motor vehicle. So if we go to what, when we discuss the passenger motor vehicles, we said what about passenger motor vehicles? We said that for capital allowances purposes on passenger motor vehicles, capital allowance on passenger motor vehicles are computed based on a maximum cost of 100,000. That was the law. So in the case that the asset was bought, a passenger motor vehicle was bought for more than this threshold, That means we are going to deem the asset that it was bought for this one for capital allowance purposes. So we are not going to charge capital. Maybe the asset was bought for 200,000. We are not going to calculate capital allowance on this 200,000. Rather, we are going to calculate on this deemed cost. That's where we found this 100,000. Okay, that's brilliant. Okay, do we have another question? Okay, if you don't have other questions, ladies and gentlemen, we can call it a day. We see each other on Monday. Have a nice weekend.